Boy, am I late to this party or what? The truth is, I just didn't know what to think about this game. Do I love it? Do I hate it? Or am I just boring and neutral on it? When the Insane Trilogy was released, I was in love with it immediately, at least all the way up until the Crash Bandicoot 3 vehicle levels. But with this game, I didn't have that, so I've given it some time now, and to end of this year, let's take a look at Spyro's Reignited Trilogy.
This is the Retro Cave, and welcome to In Retrospects.
So, of course, these games are largely the same as the originals. In the first game, Nasty Nork is a nasty dude. Then Ripto is a nasty dude. And then the Sorceress is a nasty... well, you get the point. None of these stories are that interesting, and none of them matter. Spyro is all about exploring the worlds and feeling the atmosphere. Even so, the cutscenes now are more polished with new camera angles, which makes it feel less like you're watching from afar and more like you're in the middle of it all. It feels more cinematic, for sure.
Again, not that it matters, because the story is just a means to an end, traveling from world to world.
So let's forget all this talk about stories and focus on what we're here for. How well does the gameplay hold up? Is it just as good as before? Improved even? Or did they mess up big time and should you just continue playing the original versions? If you're expecting a game that feels exactly the same as what you remember, you're in for a rough time. While you do get the option to choose between the old control scheme and a new one based on the DualShock 4 controller, Spyro feels a little... off. I personally started playing with the old controls I was used to until I got a feeling for how Spyro moved in this new game, and then switched over to the new controls, mostly because of the camera control now being mapped to the right stick instead of the shoulder buttons. Making room for R2 to become a fire button. This then helps with a smoother experience when you're charging and want to flame something, since you don't have to go from pressing square to pressing circle, which is an awkward and somewhat difficult move to make on the controller. Let's not get ahead of ourselves though. I said Spyro feels different than in the original games. If you're new to the series and this remake is your introduction, that's no problem at all. You see, Spyro doesn't control badly, just differently. There's only really an issue for players who have 2 decades of muscle memory to overcome. Spyro feels a little less smooth, his turning radius seems larger and his charge feels slower, and while charging you seem to have way less control over him. And I would say this is a bad thing, since the original levels were designed with Spyro's original movement in mind, but I rarely did ever run into a problem where a jump or an enemy was more difficult as a result of the different movements. As a matter of fact, the controls, and possibly new gameplay balancing, made some part which used to be a lot harder, very very easy. Supercharge has gotten a new builder mechanic over all 3 games, something which took me by surprise, but in the end helped me a lot. This system lets Spyro start a supercharge at a speed not that much faster than his original, but if you keep it up, it increases to a faster charge. It's more or less how supercharge would stack in Wizard Peak in the original game. This does make treetops even more of a hell, but now that there's a minimap added to the game, something which I didn't use because I know these levels better than my own house, you should be able to navigate these more difficult levels with some more ease. Spark now also has his gem finding ability right away from the start and in every one of the games. Just press L3 and Spark's will point to the closest gem, something which is very necessary as the taller grass will obscure gems more easily than in the PlayStation 1. And when those gems are green, they're pretty much invisible. Now that I mentioned Sparks, not until the very end of the first game did I notice that the health is also displayed on your controller. The light on your DualShock 4 will go from yellow to blue to green and when he is gone to red. I honestly had a couple of moments where I noticed the color on my controller without having Sparks on screen. Especially when Sparks is gone, it's difficult to tell sometimes whether you don't have any health left or if it's just chasing a butterfly or picking up a gem for you. So just looking down and seeing the red light on the controller tells you everything you need to know. The one huge downside I have with this game is the same I had with the Insane Trilogy and a lot of modern console games, the loading times. I'm aware that when this game comes to PC eventually, this problem will be solved, but see for yourself. The loading times on the PlayStation 4 Pro are just too long. You do get to control Spyro during these loading times, making him move around a little and even uses flame attack, but that gets old really really quickly. By the time I get to enter a level in the remake, I would have been well on my way in the originals.
Also, the animation of the gems you've collected flying all over the screen, that's gone.
Now I think is a good time to take a look at the games individually and see what has changed enough to be notable. The bosses in the first game are still, well, hardly bosses. I know they couldn't have changed the mistake Insomniac made way back in the day when they just put a special enemy at the end of a level and called it a boss. Nevertheless, they could have at least given you a little cutscene or even a close-up shot of the boss would have been nice, but no, it's still just a matter of hitting an enemy with no special properties a couple of times and getting a large number of gems for it. The dragons you rescue, however, all feel more unique and have actual character to them. This makes seeing some of them again in Nasty's world way more impactful, something which the first game lacked since they all more or less already looked the same to begin with. There is an incredible amount of detail in everything, ranging from the world, the enemies, to these dragons. Every character has been remade to fit this cartoonish style modern technology allows. This is certainly a benefit for the first game, but it actually hurts Riptoe's Rage, which is no longer called Gateway to Glimmer in Europe. This game always appealed to me because of the style and character design. Some characters were little more than just a mass of polygons, and while I do understand that something like this wouldn't ever work in something you call an HD remake, I'm still a little sad to see them turned into this. The environment may look more detailed and alive, but most of the characters in this game just have lost, well, their character. The look and feel that gave them the soul is now just some random Saturday morning cartoon. That being said, Robotica Farms looks amazing, and getting a power-up also changes Pyro's appearance, which is a nice touch, and the designs are amazing. The double jump is also gone. Granted, it was a glitch and it had already been removed in Year of the Dragon, but it really changed the way I played this game. While I was annoyed at first, not only at the removal of the double jump, but also other exploits like using the fly power-up in Glimmer to get to the top of this ladder without backtracking, I must say, being forced to play the game in its intended way actually was very enjoyable. Even if I still tried every last exploit trick I knew, some of which I am still convinced would work if I practiced them enough. Some of the missions for orbs are also a lot easier. I don't know if that's because of the new and improved controls or if it's a matter of being rebalanced, but the dinosaur egg mission, especially the second one, would usually take me a couple of tries to get right, but in this playthrough I did it the first time. On the other hand, we have the Alchemist mission, which frees Hunter. If you do this mission before getting the head smash, you won't be able to complete Hunter's mission and you're forced to come back later. At which point you'll have to do the Alchemist bullshit mission all over again. This is one of the most major complaints about the original game, and if you took the time not only to fix the double jump, but also other exploits, you could have damn well fixed this too. Which leaves us with only Spyro 3, Year of the Dragon. This game has the same strong and the same weak points as Riptoe's Rage. And just like before, the added new characters are what killed this game for me. Even though the gameplay has improved a fair bit, some of the mini games, like, yeah, Yeti boxing, still are a pain, and no amount of HD remastering can ever make this fun. One thing I'll give this game though is that the HD redesign of the sorcerers looks exactly as I had expected, which is more than I can say for Riptoe. She also looks a little like the Earth Queen, which somehow makes perfect sense to me.
Well, there you have it, an HD remaster of my entire childhood. We already had Crash Bandicoot, but now we also have Spyro the Dragon. The difference being is that the Insane Trilogy is the definitive way to play at least Crash Bandicoot 1, but arguably all three games. Spyro, on the other hand, doesn't quite get to the point where it replaces the original games. This is very nice to have as an alternative, as a side-by-side to the original games. But I'll still be going back to the PlayStation 1 to play those versions.